Here. I am still waiting for my associate vice president to arrive, but hopefully he'll come in before I'm finished with my my points. If not, we'll have him do a welcome for you at the very end. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you and welcome for coming to BCC today, or I should say welcome to BCC today, and we are glad to have you here for our STEM industry panel discussion. Today's industry panel is Women in STEM, and we've got a great panel set up for you today. My name is Megan Abella Bowen. I'm the Associate Dean for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math here at the college. So if you've not, if you keep hearing people talk about STEM, did I say STEAM earlier?
You did say STEM.
Oh my goodness. Close. All right, so it's a Tuesday morning. So you might hear people say STEAM, you might hear people say STEM. I am the Associate Dean for STEM, which is Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math. However, there's a lot of desire to pull in the arts into STEM these days. And for folks who work in the field, they're already gonna know that we actually do incorporate quite a bit of arts into the fields of science, technology, engineering, and math. We just may not say it that way all the time. So those of you who are here today and may be very interested in the arts, know that there's opportunities for you in the field of STEM. But to get us started today, I just wanted to go over a few pieces of information, some data that is out there that just gives you a little bit of a background and understanding of what's happening in the STEM field today. So according to the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, women make up 47% of the total U.S. workforce, but we represent a smaller portion of the workforce when it comes to areas like science and engineering. Specifically, we hold about 39% of the positions in chemistry, and material science, 28% of the positions in environmental sciences and geosciences, 16% in chemical engineering, and just 12% as civil engineers. And when we start talking about computer sciences, it becomes even a smaller portion. We are doing great in graduating folks in these fields. We do get folks out in the biological and biomedical sciences. We get a lot of women who do start their college degrees and complete their degrees in those fields. So 58% of the degrees in a bachelor's program are conferred upon women. But again, we start looking at math, that goes down to 43%. We get into engineering, it's about 18%. And then we get into, again, computer sciences, it's still around 18%. And the interesting fact is that years ago, about 20 years ago, we actually had more women graduating in computer sciences. We've seen that decline going down in the last 10 years again, and so we're trying to figure out why are folks not going into the computer science fields. So something just to think about. But why is that important? I know a lot of people will ask me, so what does it matter if we have women? When we're in the workforce, we bring our ideas and our thoughts and concerns forward. And I'll give you an example. So when you think about the auto industry, for many, many years in the auto industry, you had a lot of male engineers who were working in the auto industry. And when they would work on things like crashes and how do we deal with the impacts on the human body and crashes, those crash test dummies were based on a typical average-sized male, which would be about 180 pounds and about 5 feet 8 inches tall, 5 feet 9 inches tall. That is not the typical female. And so how a female body reacts when we get hit by, when we're in a car, is gonna react differently than a male. But nobody thought about, well, we should have different sized models when we're doing all this testing, because that was just their reality. This is what I look at every day when I get into the car, so I'm gonna develop my test dummies that same way. So once women got involved, we started looking at that and saying, hey, we need to have these for women, we need to have them for children, and it changed that conversation. Same thing when you think about the medical industry. So we think about pharmaceuticals, and we think about what's happening when we're developing drugs. For many, many years, drugs were developed based on a male model, a typical male, again, about 180 pounds. But the physiology of men and women is different, and how we metabolize drugs are different. And so it's important that women be in roles and be in positions where we are involved in developing research, developing new technologies, because we are a big player in that whole process. Secondly, it's also important because we also are consumers. So when we think about what we're buying and what people want, it's important for women to be at the table because many times women are going to want something different. And a company is going to want your input on the design, on how we make things, because what may be important to a woman is going to be different than what may be important to a man. And many times it won't, but there are times that you want to design things specifically, and having that input is important. So having women in fields in the sciences, engineering, and technology is very, very important, and we play a major role. And industry is starting to see that, and they're actively looking to hire qualified women. And so part of today's discussion, you're going to hear from four women who are working in the field, and they're going to tell you about their experiences. Some are entry, early on in their career, so you're going to hear about how they've gotten involved in their particular area, in their particular field. You're going to hear about how their path may not have been incredibly a straight line or linear. For many of you right now, especially when I go out and I talk to high school students, I hear you talking about, oh my gosh, I've got to make this important decision about where I'm going to go to college, and this is going to impact and it's going to change what happens with the rest of my life. And yes, going to college will help with that, but the decision you make today is not the end-all be-all of what happens, and you have a lot of opportunities to change, to improve, to move different directions. So don't feel that there's so much pressure on you making a decision today that you can't move that path, and that path can't go in a different direction. Secondly, also know that if you're going into a field of science, technology, engineering, or math, these are also areas that are called transferable skill sets. These are skills that you might get your degree in sciences, and you might end up working in a different field. You might go into communications. You might get a degree as engineering, but you might go into becoming a lawyer and developing patents. There's a lot of different ways to use that degree. So also know that your path may wind as you go along. So with that, and then the last couple things I'm going to say, usually my associate vice president would tell you this. So you guys are here today. We're going to be here for a little over an hour and 20 minutes. We've got four great speakers. This is your opportunity to ask questions. And I don't want you to be shy. If there's something you want to know, if there's somebody up here who has talked about something, take that opportunity. Raise your hand. We'll bring over a microphone. You can ask a question. If you're a little shy, you can ask a question. I'll repeat it in the microphone for you. But this is a great opportunity to learn and to hear directly from folks who are in the field. And we've got some really great folks on our panel today. So I'll do a quick introduction of who they are. And then what we're going to do today is each of them is going to speak. After each individual speaks, they will then do a question and answer. So you don't have to think of holding on to that question. You can answer. We'll do those questions right after each person speaks. And then at the end, if there's still time available, we will then open it up for continued questions and answers. So on our panel today, just quickly, and then I'll give a little bit more information on each of them as we bring them forward. We have Dr. Liese Siemann. She's a computational biologist with experience in modeling a wide range of biological systems. She's got a great background in math and sciences. Next to her is Kim Bellefeuille. Kim is an engineer, and she is a graduate of BCC, and she will be talking about her background with us there. The next person to her is Kayla DeRosa. Kayla is an EDP, or an Electronic Data Processing System Analyst here at BCC. She is also a BCC graduate, and she'll be telling you a little bit about what she does and her background and her path. And then our final speaker is Dr. Sunshine, I'm going to do this again, Menezes. Menezes. So Dr. Menezes will also be speaking. She is the Executive Director of the Metcalfe Institute at the University of Rhode Island, Graduate School of Oceanographic, School of Oceanography, sorry. And she's going to talk to you about what she's been doing down there, which I think, again, many of you will find of great interest. With that, let me just see, I did hear my phone go. All right, with that, we are going to go ahead and start with the presentations. So I've asked Dr. Liese Siemann to go ahead and be our first speaker. Let me give you just a little bit more background on Dr. Siemann. As I mentioned, she is a computational biologist with experience modeling a wide range of biological systems from pilot whale population structure to animal camouflage patterns to seasonal distributions of New England fish populations. She's worked at numerous locations down in Woods Hole, and she'll probably go over some of that. She holds a Bachelor's of Science degree from Cornell University in biology, and she has a PhD from the MIT Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute in biological oceanography. Now, we have two biological oceanographers on our panel today, but they're going to tell you very different backgrounds of ways that you could use that degree, which I think is really quite intriguing today. So with that, I'm going to invite Dr. Liese Siemann to go ahead and tell us a little bit about herself.
Okay, is this working? It is working. Fantastic. Hi, everyone. So I am completely unprepared, so I'm just going to give you a little bit of background about how I got to where I am, and then hopefully you'll ask questions so we can fill in the blanks. So probably like a lot of you, when I was in, you know, sort of junior high school, I was pretty animal obsessed. In high school and early college, I was debating between becoming a large animal vet and a whale biologist, which is probably something pretty familiar to people. By the time I finished college, and I just majored in biology, so that gave me the option of doing whatever I wanted. Took a lot of math because I love math. I had decided to go the marine biology route. I actually went into graduate school in a whale lab where we studied whale behavior. But I had a background in cell biology by then from doing research as an undergraduate. So I actually did marine mammal genetics work. My PhD was on pilot whale genetics, and because we just found some weird things going on with their genetics, I ended up starting to do modeling. So half of my PhD was modeling populations. So that got me sucked right into doing some computer programming really early on, which is incredibly valuable. You will never regret knowing how to computer program, ever. It will get you anywhere you want to go because it's a really necessary skill set. And at that point, though, my final year of graduate school, my first son was born. So that kind of threw a monkey wrench into my career plans. And so I became an adjunct teacher. I taught classes on marine management and conservation and on whale biology. And then when my second son was born, I sort of stepped out of the career path and raised my kids until my younger son was back in school. At that point, I wanted to get sort of slowly back into science. And so I started working for a partnership that connected our local schools with all of the institutions down in Woods Hole. So it was just a way to bridge between the schools and all the scientists and bring scientists into the schools. By the time my younger son was old enough and in school all day, I was really itching to get back into research. So I started working at the Marine Biological Laboratory. And my new animal obsession at that point had shifted from whales to octopus. And so I went to the octopus lab, started raising their colony of octopus and cuttlefish. Again, realized that my math and my skill set with math and with programming opened up an opportunity for me to start doing computer vision modeling because we studied camouflage. And so I learned how to program in MATLAB and started writing code to do that, still keeping my hands in the field and working with the animals. But it, you know, they're for various reasons, and this will happen in your career, it just wasn't working for me anymore. And so I sought a new position. Again, because I'm very good at math, I moved into fisheries modeling. I found a job where I could use my math skills to model seasonal populations. And again, just because I'm always looking for new ways to use my math and my science degree, I have recently decided to start studying computational fluid dynamics, looking at the way that water flows over gear, so we can develop new ways to prevent fishing gear from catching sea turtles, whales, fish that are not focal species. So I've sort of gone all over the place. I took a big gap in my career to raise my kids, but you know, I sort of kept my fingers in the science world, and so I was able to get back when I was done. And I have shifted my focus a lot over the years, and I probably will again. You know, I get bored pretty easily, actually, and because I'm good at with math and with technology, I can usually find something new to do pretty easily. Anyway, so I'm hoping you guys will ask questions about how I got here. You know, I imagine my interests are very similar, at least at a high school level, to what you were, because you know, horses and whales are pretty common. So please ask me questions, because you know, it's easier to answer questions than sit here and talk about myself.
So with that, do I have folks who would like to start off with a question? Don't be shy. All right, up here.
Thank you.
What does it mean to computer model a population?
So let me just repeat that for, what does it mean to computer model a population?
Good question, because you read about people doing that a lot in you know, just popular science literature, and you're like, what are they talking about? In my case, what we do is we look at how many animals are caught in fishing surveys, and then we also have a lot of information about environmental parameters like temperature, depth, where they were, you know, anything else we might know about the ocean and the benthic habitat in that area, and we try to predict what's going on. By doing that, we can help the fisheries management councils decide when and where to let fishermen go to fish in with the hopes of not catching things they're supposed to catch. And so it's basically just taking whatever information you have and trying to find a way to correlate it to what you're interested in. But it's messy, and it's very math heavy. But it's also very valuable because it's surprisingly important for all the decisions they make that have wide-ranging ramifications for not only the fish populations and the whale populations and turtles, but also just for fishermen, everybody who's trying to make a living that way. So,
another question? I've got a question way back up here, so hold on, we're going to bring a microphone to you.
Was it easy to switch career paths?
It's not easy, and you kind of need to be willing to put yourself out there and try something, you know, be willing to fail, but at the same time have enough confidence in yourself to believe that you can learn something new, which is something I think you just gain as you move through your life. So I think that it would be very hard if I hadn't kept talking to people and made sure that people knew I was still interested. But at the same time, and the trick too is to do your job, but then like carve out a little thing on the side where you can try something crazy and new, and then if you're successful, people are like, go for it. You know, so it's sort of a balancing act.
All right, we have another question in the back.
Okay. So you said you did computer programming and tracking animals. Is
yep.
there a specific way you have to track animals?
In terms of the way I originally did tracking was that you can actually take genetic samples from animals and tell who's who, and then if you catch them again, you can figure out it was the same animal or not. But most of the tracking work I do now actually is with sea turtles, and we glue tags to their backs, actually. We catch them, we bring them on board a ship, we glue tags, and then we can track them, and then try to model and figure out why they're moving around the way they are, why and when they dive, you know, why and when they you know, migrate north or south. So a lot of mapping GIS work to do that kind of thing.
So we'll have another question back here. Yep, please.
Yep.
Oh, wait. Can we, we'll go back here and then we'll come up to the next person. Sorry about that.
Do you feel that having a child was one of the challenges you went through in your field?
Having a child? Challenges, absolutely. I mean, I think pretty much any woman who's tried to keep her career going will tell you that having children, you know, threw things off a little. You know, just anecdotally, I have a brother who's just a little bit younger than me, and his career path was very linear. He did exactly what you're supposed to do, you know, postdoc, right into the professorship, and in a little way, I'm jealous, but you know, it's doable, I guess. So I would never say don't have children, but just realize that if you do step off your career path, you're going to have to get back on, but it can be done. Can you repeat that? I think I'm...
As rising sea levels in the ocean, let you change your study of field?
I think... So what people do today in terms of scientific research is unfortunately really driven by where the money is. We spend a lot of our time writing grants trying to convince someone to give us money to study the things we're interested in. And so rising sea level, climate change, is... up until now, it has been a great way to get money. People worried about it. So in some degree, it has. And so my fisheries research, actually, one of the big considerations is warming sea temperatures and whether or not fish populations are shifting. So I'd say simply because that's where the money is, it has changed my career to some degree.
We'll yeah. have one here and then one over here. Go ahead.
I actually have a great work day because I do what I need to do every day. I sort of know what I have to get done during a week, but in terms of how I get there, it changes a lot. My typical work day, I'll go in and I'll start, you know, writing some programming to do statistics, and then I'll shift over to doing some mapping, and then I might go outside and work on some of my gear, and then I'll come back in and I'll write work on a paper that I'm writing. So Some days I'll spend the whole day programming. So it really varies a lot, which to me is good because I wouldn't want to do the same thing every day. You know, but that's partially because I'm as high as I am in my career that I dictate my day. But yeah, it's pretty flexible, and I do a lot of different things and work with a lot of different computer programs. I'm indoors, outdoors. Sometimes I'm out at sea, so.
Got another question over here.
When you were working with your animals, how were you able to work with them and do math? Like, I feel like those don't go together.
They actually were fantastic together, and I'll tell you why. Sitting at a computer writing code is really boring after a while. Your head gets a little crazy, you just get really tired of sitting at your desk, and for me, I'd come in, I'd start doing that, and then when it just got to where I couldn't sit there anymore, I would go down the hall and I'd take care of the animals. It was like a great break that was part of my job. And I actually miss that now because I don't have that kind of break in my new job as much. So I can shift my focus into another project, but I don't have the opportunity to go down the hall and work with animals. So it was actually a really great mix.
So we're gonna take one more question if we have it, and then we're gonna move on. Back over here.
Yep.
Is there another student that had a question? All right, go ahead.
Who or what inspired me? I'd say it was a mix of my parents, actually. My dad was a physics professor, loved math, being a physicist, and I grew up loving math, and you know, he would give us physics lessons at the dinner table, use us to make videos for his classes, and so I really got exposed to that early on. And my mom was someone who just, animal-obsessed. We always had 10-plus animals in my house. We were rescuing orphan squirrels, and we had horses, and so I think the combination of them led me to be a biologist and led me to love math at the same time. You know, I remember my dad brought home a computer for me when I was about 12, and it looked like a cash register. The programming was on a piece of paper like the cash register receipt. So I started playing with that stuff early on and really grew to appreciate it. So it's the two parents together, I think, mixing their interests and their passions.
All right, so we'll take more questions at the end as well, but at this point, I'd like to go ahead and pass it on over to our next speaker. Kim Bellefeuille is a project manager for Kidde-Fenwal Incorporated. It's a manufacturer of fire protection and ignition temperature control products. She'll tell you what that all means. Since joining Kidde-Fenwal over a year ago, she's assumed the responsibility for managing multiple projects at the company, where she is where she creates project schedules, oversees procurement, develops budgets, and troubleshoots issues as they arrive. As I had mentioned earlier, Kim is a graduate of BCC. She received her Associate of Science degree here in Engineering Technology?
Math and Science.
And she is currently working on her bachelor's degree at Wentworth Institute of Technology as a project manager while still working full time. So with that, I'll pass it over to Kim.
Hi. So the fancy talk of what I do for a living. The company I work for manufactures fire suppression equipment. Mostly for industrial type, so manufacturing facilities, any type of, like, so we have contracts with Frito-Lay, we've got contracts with oil rigs, with a lot of Middle Eastern companies that produce oil and gas and all of that. We focus mainly on clean gases, so wet and dry chemicals, just anything that, so for us, we develop new technology pretty much on a monthly basis to try and keep like our carbon footprints down, because that's huge. Places like China, they have strict regulations on the type of gases and chemicals that we can use. So we're constantly trying to adjust to how the climate changes and how we affect the environment with our products. Sorry, I'm like really nervous. it was a really long and not linear path journey to where I am. I've probably switched my major like 3 times. I originally went to college, like, you know, right out of high school. I wanted to be a lawyer. I did everything you're supposed to do, all the after school work, all of the like the volunteering and working at the courthouse. And I did my senior internship at the city attorney's office and did the whole thing. And then after 2 semesters of college of following my dreams, I realized I was not made to be a lawyer. I mean, Megan can tell you, I pretty much speak my mind. Political correctness is not something I'm fully conscious of. So I tend to just rub people the wrong way with what I say sometimes. So I had to find a new path for me, but I also had developed a ton of skills that I had no idea what to do with. So eventually I came up here and I tried mechanical engineering. That's an interesting way of how I got there, but I wanted to just save the world, pretty much. Like, I wanted to just make things more efficient. I was more interested in just quality, and I wanted, at one point I was thinking about being an aerospace engineer because, I mean, that's just cool. Who doesn't want to build rocket ships and go to the moon? But I was a non-traditional student. I was, I think, like 23 or 24 when I started back up here, and it was just really, really hard to be working full-time, having to go to school full-time, and try and figure out what I wanted to be when I grew up. So eventually it was a combination of Megan and my calculus teacher who introduced me to project management, which was fantastic. It was a way for me to stay in a STEM field, but also took everything, all the skills I had learned from high school, from college, from the jobs I had in between, and be able to apply it. It doesn't sound like it's a STEM field, project management, but it's complicated. I have to be able to know a little bit about everything, about software engineering, about mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and everything in between, so that I can ask my guys the right questions. I can keep the team focused on what the end project is. It's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of paperwork, and it's also a lot of putting out little fires, no pun intended, to try and just keep things going, because our projects take years of hard work and problems to kind of get to fruition. But in the end, we're building equipment that's going to save lives someday, so it's very rewarding, and it was worth every mistake I made to get to this point.
Kim, tell them a little bit about, you also are a reservist, is that correct?
I was, yeah. So I was in the Navy Reserve. I was an equipment operator, basically worked construction for the Navy, and that's kind of what led me to looking into engineering. The happiest moments of my life were when I was on orders, like building stuff, working with the equipment. I was really good at it, and my officers, who were civil and mechanical engineers, kind of led me on the path to engineering, which is awesome, and it was really great. I loved every minute of being in the Navy, and I'm actually going back in next year, so.
All right, so now we're gonna open up the floor for questions for Kim. Do we have anybody? So we've got some questions starting up in the back. Okay, so go ahead.
Who inspired you to do what you do today?
Yeah, like 100 things. Everything from Megan being completely relentless and pushing me when I was definitely on the verge of quitting several times, to my parents, who were just completely awesome and never said no when I gave them a crazy idea. Like, I think I was 5 and I was like, I'm going to be an astronomer. And they were like, yeah, go for it. Like, so just there's everyone, friends, family, everyone has just been really great.
Probably got one answer. Behind you.
Were you ever afraid when you got into the Army? I mean, the Navy? Like, were you afraid to get hurt?
So I never actually got to deploy, but I work in construction, so it was like 99% male environment, so the chances of getting hurt were very high because they do really dumb stuff. So you kind of just had to go with the flow and like just know that, like, no matter, you know, if we got hurt, like, you know, on the equipment or on a job site, that, you know, we all had really extensive training so we could take care of each other.
That would be her non-PC response. yep, down here, and then we'll go back. No, you're fine.
Hello, so you explained how a lawyer was just not right for you. So how does your career now help, you know, coexist with your personality?
So I had to be extremely, like, analytical. I had to be able to just, like, look at the big picture but still see, you know, the leaves amongst the trees, and I kind of developed just a lot of ways to just look at the bigger picture but be able to keep the little things in mind and vice versa, and that was really helpful. And also, just despite how I'm doing it today, communication was very important, being able to get my point across and to talk to the audience that I'm, you know, was talking to, because it's really easy to know everything but talk to people that don't know everything but still talk above their heads, and so trying to find the balance was important.
There's one over here first.
D-
Did you ever second guess yourself working in the STEM major?
Working in what? STEM. Oh, yes, all the time. The most fun part of getting my degree for me was all the science classes I had to take because it was just all the physics and all the questions, and I had like amazing teachers. The hardest part was all the math and all the calculus you had to do in order to kind of get through those classes. And the math for me was like the hardest part. So that's what put doubts in my head all the time. I was pretty much stalking my calculus teacher every day because get through the classes. But if you love something that much, you kind of just have to push through it. And I had a great support system. So despite the doubts, I made it through.
I'm going to ask him to actually delve a little bit more into that. Because many times we get students who come in and they're going into a field and they'll hit the wall in a subject. In engineering, a lot of times that's math. And a lot of students will make that connection, I can't do math, therefore I can't be an engineer. How did you work through that? You just kind of alluded to it, but I want you to talk a little bit more about it because it wasn't easy.
It was painful. So I took calculus 2, I think, twice and almost had to repeat differential equations because it was just the way my mind works. I overthink everything. Like, I could ace all the homeworks and, ace all the in-class assignments and do all of that, but when it got to, like, actually taking the test, forget it. I overthought everything. I just was... doubted everything. I had, race marks everywhere, but it was very challenging. Like, I knew the stuff. I knew I could do it. I just couldn't prove it, and that was just the hardest thing. And it was just utilizing my instructor because she understood the way I was thinking, and utilizing the tutoring center and getting help from students inside the class. And it was so hard, and it was like I wanted to quit every day. But you push through it because because you can't do math doesn't mean you can't stay in a science field. You just have to work that much harder for it.
All right. We have a young gentleman back over here I know has been waiting. Can you talk loud? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Please?
Okay, so you said before you did a law major, and I said, was mechanical, because back at the middle school campus, Ms. Pavo was talking about major and you have a fallback major.
So there was probably, I want to say, like a 4-year break in between me getting my just AA in general education to me deciding on engineering. I didn't have a fallback major because it was what I was going to do. I was going to be a lawyer. I was going to save the world. I mean, that was my thing. And so when I eventually realized law wasn't free, it was kind of traumatic, and I kind of went through like a breakup. So there was a huge gap, and it was me kind of really focusing on being like, all right, what kind of skills do I have? What do I like to do? And what kind of, what career path can I go for that? So I didn't have a fallback major, and it's probably important to do that. That I should have had that, but I didn't. It wasn't originally my fallback major.
Right. We'll take 2 more. So we've got this one and somebody back here.
In the situation of your company going bankrupt, where would you go and what would you do?
Oh my God! What? I mean, that's intense. Okay. Wow. Cool.
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Okay. So the question was, in case of your company going bankrupt, what would you do now?
Wow. So as a project manager, I've gotten to do a lot of different types of projects, and some of the projects I've had are quality projects, meaning a product has failed in the field, so now I have to walk the engineers through the process of fixing that problem, of finding out how many of our customers have this problem and how we're going to get it to them and all that stuff. And I realized I really, really love the quality side of engineering, and so I would probably... If I had to leave, I would probably find a job where I could do that and just focus on the quality aspect of it, mostly because I really love the fast-paced, quick-thinking environment. Like, you have zero room to overthink it. You just have to make the right decisions right off the bat and go with it, and it's, I really like the quality side of it. So I would probably find something in that area.
Do we have?
Dude, there's someone over there.
We have somebody in the very back.
So you said that you used to want to be a lawyer, and now you work in the science
sciences field, so why don't you put them together and be a forensic scientist?
Okay, so again, the question was, how did you put your, she originally started as a lawyer, and how does she connect now her science background with what she was doing initially? Oh, would she ever think about being a forensic scientist?
No. just mostly because I don't know. I really like what I do now. I think just this skills that I learned, you know, trying to go through all the classes to be a lawyer helped me. But I really like what I do now, and forensic science kind of freaks me out a little bit. But I kind of like the environmental stuff I have to deal with now, and the I would want to stay in like this type of field.
All right, we'll go over here.
Has anybody ever doubted you, said you couldn't do it because you're a girl?
Yeah. I actually didn't see it as much when I was in the Navy, because mostly I got to prove that I knew how to operate the equipment, like right off the bat, so they kind of backed off from that. But there are a few older engineers at my current, where I currently work, who still kind of give me pushback when I try to make decisions for my team, or when I, you know, overrule them on something, just because it's like it's an old mentality where, you know, I'm young, I'm a female, I don't have an engineering degree, like a bachelor's in it, so I have no idea what they're talking about, and so they can just, you know, make the decisions for me, which you kind of have to nip in the bud very quickly. You have to stand up for yourself, and I have a lot of backup. I have a lot of from the engineers I work with who know that I know what I'm talking about. So those voices get silenced after a while, but every now and then you still get a lot of pushback. It's hard and kind of sad.
Great. Well, with that one, I'm going to transition on to our next speaker. I know Kayla's been waiting over there, anxious to talk. So let me just give you a little bit about background on Kayla. Kayla is working here at BCC. She is an electronic data processing system analyst 1. And she began her IT career at BCC first as a work study here as a student. And then upon graduation, she took a position here at the college as a computer information, as an IT, as a technician 1. And she just recently has moved into her current position in January of 2017. Again, Ms. DeRosia is currently working on completing a Bachelor's of Science degree at the University of Massachusetts in Lowell, and she is focused on computer information systems. And with that, I'm gonna pass it over to Kayla.
Hello. As I'm looking at many of you right now, I'm noticing that most of you are from a vocational school, correct? All right, awesome. So I also graduated high school in 2009 from a vocational high school. I actually went to Bristol Aggie in an ag mechanics degree, which meant that I fixed tractors, lawnmowers, stuff like that. Something completely different than what I got into now. I remember being in your situation and thinking, what am I going to do for the rest of my life? I have no idea what I want to do. It's not mechanics. And I met someone from BCC, and he was telling me how he did a work study program for the CIS department, and he loved it, and that the teachers were so motivational, and they helped him along the way. So I decided, you know, hey, I'll apply and see what happens. I instantly got into the program and thought I knew computers until I started taking some of the CIS classes here, and I was like, whoa, I don't know anything. What I know is completely nothing what they're showing me. So I was never a good student, I guess you could say. You know, I don't like doing homework. You know, I'd rather go out and do stuff. But my teachers here at BCC were awesome. They had so much faith in me, and they pushed me, and they helped me become the IT tech that I am today. I loved everything about it. And, you know, I graduated in 2013 at, you know, 23 years old with a state job for BCC. It was awesome. And I recently just decided to go back to school and get my bachelor's degree because I'd rather just keep learning, because in the technology fields, things are constantly changing and you gotta be up to date with everything. And that's one of the things I really, really enjoy about this field. So right now I'm currently taking part-time classes at UMass Lowell online, fast track. And it is possible. You know, I work 70 plus hours a week. I always have 2 or more jobs. You know, I'm not one to just sit around, do nothing. And so currently I work at BCC full time, and I have 2 part-time jobs. I'm sure some of you have met me at the mall in Dartmouth and whatnot, selling you shoes at Journeys and stuff. I mean, I like to stay busy. So with motivation, you guys can Just live your dreams. Just have fun with it and whatnot. But, you know, being a woman in the field is definitely tough. You know, you do have some, you look around and you notice, like, in my office right now, I have all guys, and not one of them treat me differently, and that's what I love about it, is we're all willing to share and learn different things about each other, and they're very motivating and pushing each other to do better. My average day at BCC was coming in, I'm the first line of defense. I'm the person you call when your account's broken or anything like that. I really love people interactions and helping you guys feel that not being scared of technology. Knowing technology and literacy is very important in today's world. You know what I mean? You guys have cell phones glued to your hands all the time. And especially with school, everything's online. These are things that you want to know and be prepared for. You know, my path has been pretty straightforward compared to everybody else. I kind of got in the field, it clicked really, really well, and I loved everything about it. So, does anyone have any questions or wants to know a little bit more about myself?
Yep. We've got a first one right here.
So you mentioned that none of the men treated you differently. Did you say that the concept of most men antagonizing women in the field is kind of misconstrued?
You know, for the BCC family, I've never had that feeling of not being like, oh, we're better than you because you're a woman or anything like that. You know, I've had the opportunity to feel welcomed and part of the team and not really gender-based. So that's really fortunate for me. You know, other fields, you know, I've only worked at BCC for stuff like that, but I can't see it happening here at BCC like that.
Do I have another question up here in the front? All right, we'll head back right here to this gentleman.
While I'm walking up, I do have to say that what she does is, if there's ever a problem with your computer, you call ITS, and when I make that phone call, I pray that it's Michaela. That's Kayla. So that's the highest compliment I can pay someone.
So you've mentioned about technology being constantly advancing. With technology being constantly advancing, and if it advanced to the point where you won't be able to learn that much of it anymore, and the studies become more difficult and difficult as technology gets better and better, would you ever second guess yourself to the point of quitting your job?
Absolutely not. I love learning new things. As I mentioned before, you know, I'm a big go-getter. I like to learn. Like, I'll find something at work, and then I'll actually go home and research more and try to implement it. With my job now, especially with working with so many students, you guys are always whipping in these cool new devices, and you're like, oh, how do I get my email on this? I'm like, I've never seen one of those. What is that? So I like to stay on top of it, and I can't see me not continuing this career.
Okay, and then we'll come back down here. Also, just if I'm missing people over here, please just shout out and say we have a question over here, because I apologize if I keep forgetting to look over to the right. Go ahead.
So, what? I don't get it. What are we doing?
You go. Let this one over here go first, and then you can go first. Second.
Whoever you want.
Veronica, your side.
Do you feel like most guys are doubt women?
I feel like most guys doubt women.
You know, and other, you know, I don't feel that definitely where I am. But I can see it happening, you know what I mean? Especially like with high school, like being in the ag mechanics fields, you know, everyone just kind of looks at all the girls and is like, what are they doing here? Like, they just want a free ride. But I do see that sometimes men will look and be like, oh, I'm bigger, I'm stronger. And it's not totally that way. You know, there's always other ways to do things. You don't have to be strong to do different things and whatnot.
Question over on
okay, them. So considering you went to Bristol Aggie, right?
Yep.
And you said you repaired
tractors
and lawnmowers,
correct?
Right? And you said you came to BCC and you thought you knew a lot about computers.
Yes.
And you really didn't. Was that a challenge for you in the course?
Absolutely. I thought, you know, what I did at home was a lot of computer stuff. You know, I was that person that the family member calls, hey, can you come fix my computer, stuff like that. And then I remember taking one of my classes at BCC, and there was no, you know how like you look at Windows and there's like a beautiful screen, there's icons and stuff like that? No, this class was a black and white screen, and you had to type stuff, and I was like, what is this? Like, this is DOS, this is command line, this is what you need to know. I'm like, oh boy. So I did have to put a lot of effort into learning this stuff, but thankfully, you know, my CIS teachers were able to find like other students. We had student partners where we'd work with each other, ask each other questions, and that really helped with my career here at BCC.
All right, we're gonna go here, and then we have a gentleman, or a young lady, over here. So we'll go here first.
How come you chose online school instead of driving to school in real life?
How come you chose, you said online school instead of driving to school?
Well, UMass Lowell's pretty far. And I work here at BCC Monday through Friday, 7:30 to 3:30. So most of the classes are in the morning for my degree. And what's really cool about online classes is that it's convenient. I can sign in when I need to and whatnot. And that, to me, with my 70-hour work week, is the easiest way for me to go back to school. Unfortunately, I can't go back full time unless I cut my workload back. But I think part-time, within time, this is perfect for me. I take two classes a semester and eventually graduate with my bachelor's in computer information system.
Over here, sorry. Go ahead. Pass her the microphone, please.
You said technology is important in modern-day life, well, something around that basis. Mm-hmm. But why, other than the fact that we have phones and cell phones that people use almost 24/7, why do you believe that?
Well, technology is around us. I don't know if you've seen gone to Best Buy recently, but refrigerators have TVs in them now. That's like crazy. You know, I mean, cars now have TVs in them. They have GPS. They connect to your phone. You mean, technology is all around you at this point. You mean, look at the equipment that we're using here to record, and you know, every cell phone now. Look at the cameras on the iPhones and the Google Pixel. That's just, to me, mind-boggling how advanced technology has come. When I was, you know, I remember back being in kindergarten, and the school got their first computer. It was a Macintosh. The screen was green. Like, that's what you saw. And I remember playing Oregon Trail, like, and I was so excited about that. Then to see what we have now in the computer game systems that we have VR now, like, that's just, to me, it's crazy.
We'll take a question down here, and then we'll come back over to this side. While we're getting, who is the one raising their hand here? Okay, if you'll pass the mic over. But Kayla, while we're waiting for the mic to get over, programming languages do you think are really good for a student to start with, or do you see being the most common as a starting point?
I would definitely, if you're looking into programming, C++ and C are very important. Those are one of the most common ones used for a lot of things. I just finished a C programming class, and I wanted to rip my hair out because it was online and fast track. But with enough determination, I was able to go through it, and thank God for Google. It was a lot of fun.
So you said that you don't really see a bias between male and female like differences here at BCC, but do you experience that at any of the other jobs that you've worked at?
For the most part, no, because a lot of people see me, and I've always held two or more jobs. Like right now I'm working three jobs, and the people that I work with, they see that determination, and you know, no matter how long of a day I've had at BCC, you know, I work 14-hour days, so as soon as I leave BCC, I'll go to one of my other jobs, and they can see that I come in happy, and I'm willing to do whatever. I don't fight about anything, and I just do it, and a lot of people give me respect for that, so I don't get that issue.
We have one more over here first, and then we'll come back over to this side.
Did you consider any other careers?
Back in the day, I wanted to be a vet, but I could never put down an animal. That would break my heart. So I like computers. The reason why I like computers, if a computer dies, it's okay. You can buy a new one.
Let's take one more question over here. All right. Do we have one more over here? Okay, so let's go this direction. Because I've got the same group of people over here asking questions, which I think is great, but I'd love to see some more people ask questions as well.
How did you go from fixing tractors and lawnmowers to like doing stuff with computers?
How did I go through that route? So basically, you know, graduating, didn't know what I wanted to do. And I was working at the Fall River Country Club, and I remember talking to one of my friends who is currently at BCC in the CISO program. And he was like, try computer networking. I'm like, what is it about? Like, what is it? He's like, you know, you're the jack of all trades. He's like, it's a good starting ground. And that was enough. You know, my family, I come from a family of nurses, and I did not want to deal with being responsible for someone's life, like I said before. You know, I would rather just buy a new computer and call it a day. So that's what really kind of got me was my friend who pushed me into that career, and I loved it.
Last question, and we'll move on.
So technology is constantly advancing. Also, it's hacking. So have you ever dealt with a person that's trying to hack in something or a network?
I personally have it. I'm on the front line. I'm the person you'd call and be like, hey, I just got this crazy spam message. I think I'm getting hacked. From there, I would then send it over to someone else who has that capability of looking into it and tracking it down. But yes, computer hacking is a big thing. And as you guys are doing more and more things, new technology advances and whatnot, so it's something to, you know, internet security is going to be a big field. Security in general is going to be huge, because think about what you guys are doing. You guys are sending stuff via the cloud. You know what I mean? Who's watching that? How do you protect that? You know, who has access to it and who doesn't have access to it?
Great. So we're going to go on to our final speaker. Again, at the end, we're probably going to have time so we can ask more questions. And so with that, I'm going to move over to Dr. Sunshine Menezes. She has served as the executive director of the Metcalfe Institute at the University of Rhode Island Graduate School of Oceanography, and she is the associate director for communications at the in the URI GSO Office of Marine Programs since 2006. Prior to focusing her communication efforts on improving news coverage for the environment, she developed national and state level environmental policy, first as a Dean John Nouse, National Sea Grant Marine Policy Fellow with Congressman Frank Pallone Jr., and later as part of the multidisciplinary team at the URI Coastal Resource Center. Dr. Menezes has received her Bachelor's of Science degree in Zoology from Michigan State University and a PhD in Biological Oceanography from URI Graduate School of Oceanography. With that, we'll pass it over to you.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. All right, so I have kind of a lot of twists and turns in my story of how I came to be right here, so I wanted to tell you about some of those. So first of all, I went to, as Megan said, I started by going to get my bachelor's degree at Michigan State University. I'm from Michigan. I grew up in northern Michigan in a very, very small town, and I went to a very small high school where I was kind of a big fish in a little pond. I got good grades, whatever. So I wanted to go to a college where I could just fade into the background and be one of many, 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 many people, so nobody who knew who I was. And Michigan State has about 45,000 students, so that was very easy to do. And I chose to study science because science was really hard for me. So I had done well in my science classes and stuff in high school, but it was never something that came naturally to me. I love languages, and I really wanted to be an interpreter for the UN at one point in my life. And I said this to my mom, and she was like, honey, we're not the kind of people that, you know, you can't do that kind of job. We don't have money. You're not, you know, it's people that have money that can go have a job like being an interpreter at the UN. We're not those people. And I was like, oh, okay. Okay, so, what do I want to do? Well, I enjoy science, and I liked, for example, you know, a lot of my family lives in Miami, and so when we got to visit family in Miami, I would go to the ocean, and if I found something dead, like, I'd like to poke at it and open it up and see what was inside. So clearly, I had this interest in playing with animals, even if they're dead. So I decided to study science. So I studied zoology at Michigan State University, and it was hard. It was not easy. And so one of the things that I think is really important about studying any STEM field is your willingness to be persistent. We've heard that over and over on this panel here, and I can't stress it enough. It's really important. It's not, you don't have to be the smartest person in the room. You do need to be the most persistent person in the room. And I think especially this is the case for a lot of women. I remember thinking when I was in college that the men that were in my science classes, it just, everything seemed really easy for them. The way that they kind of acted about the classes and the information, it felt to me at the time like it was just easy. And it wasn't that it was necessarily easy for them, I found out later. It was that they had a lot more confidence in their ability to do these things. Like, they weren't starting from a point of thinking, I probably can't do this. And I was. And a lot of the women that I knew were starting from that point. So it's really important to remember that you just have to keep pushing, you know? Like, that is what gets you through a lot of hurdles in life. So I went to Michigan State, and then I took a year off, and I actually went to Brazil, and I traveled for a couple of months because that's where my family's from, and I had never been before, and so I took a couple months and traveled around there, and that was awesome. And then I did a whole bunch of internships, and then I ended up going to graduate school at the University of Rhode Island at the Graduate School of Oceanography with Dr. Rapine, who is a faculty member here. She and I were in the same class. And so once again, I was faced with my lack of confidence about being able to do well in this program, because this was a really intensive PhD program. And right off the bat, one of the classes that we had to take was all of the oceanography incoming students had to take these four classes: biological oceanography, chemical oceanography, geological oceanography, and physical oceanography. And the physical oceanography class was a whole bunch of math, which was always kind of my nemesis. And I was very nervous about this class. Because I was a PhD student, it was required that you had to have a B or better in the class. And if you didn't get a B or better, then you couldn't keep going. You had to take the class over again to get the PhD. I got a B minus. And it was, at that point in my life, it was like one of the most embarrassing things ever. And I know, you're like, whatever, B minus, like that's not so bad. Well, it was, because the fact that I got that B minus meant that I had to retake the class. Everybody knew, this is how I felt, everybody knew that I had to retake that class, that I wasn't smart enough, whatever, didn't know enough to get it right the first time. And that really, really like broke me for a little while, you know? So I took it again the next year and aced it. And you know what? Nobody cares, because it was done. You know, I now what shows on my transcript, not that anybody ever looks at my transcript at this point in my life, is that I got an A in that class. And it doesn't matter. The only reason anybody is ever going to know that I had to take that class twice is because I'm telling you, you know? So I say this because, again, it's all about persistence. It's about remembering that sometimes there are these hurdles that at the time feel huge and like, you know, they're you can't possibly get over them, or so personally embarrassing that they're really awful, but they're not that big a deal in the scheme of things. You just kind of have to push through those moments and you'll get there. While I was in graduate school, I learned another very important lesson, which is that you have to take advantage of opportunities that come along. So a couple of opportunities came along for me that were really random. One of them was that there was a chance to go study in Brazil, take a class in the Brazilian Amazon, and it was going to be paid for by the U.S. National Science Foundation. And my advisor actually told me about this because he knew that my family was Brazilian and I had been there before. And the class was about the actual Amazon. It had nothing to do with oceanography at all. But I wrote an application anyway, in Portuguese, by the way. And my Portuguese is, well, right now it's horrible. At that time it was better, but it still wasn't great. I had to write an essay in Portuguese. And there were two scholarships for this program, and for two scholarships for Americans to attend. There are going to be a lot of other attendees that were from South American countries. And I was the only person who applied in the whole country. And so I got it, you know. So opportunity. There was an opportunity. And even though it was a little bit of a sidetrack from my graduate research, I went for it, and I got it, and I got to spend an all-expenses-paid month in the Amazon studying all of these different ecosystems in the Amazon. It was amazing. It was the most amazing thing I could ever imagine. We worked really hard all day long, and then we danced all night long, and it was like the best. Another opportunity that I took advantage of was applying for this this National Sea Grant Fellowship that's a marine policy fellowship. So the idea is to get people who study marine science into positions in DC, either working with members of Congress or working in executive branches like the State Department or the EPA or the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, to do all kinds of different things. But basically to learn how policy, marine policy, is made. And so I got one of those fellowships, and I worked with a congressman from New Jersey, and I was supposed to be helping him, responding to issues that he was working on. He was on two committees. One was the Fisheries and Wildlife Subcommittee, so I was helping him prepare statements and research stuff regarding that policy or that committee's activities. And he was also on the House Energy and Commerce Committee and dealt with energy issues. I wasn't supposed to work on that. But my first day in the job, my first week in the job, my supervisor in that office said, I'm pregnant and I'm gonna be on maternity leave in August and you're gonna be in charge of all of the environment and energy stuff. And I was like, what? What? That doesn't make any sense because I don't know anything about energy. But whatever, there it was. So that's what I did. And this is one of the first times in my life that I realized how transferable my skills are as a scientist. I hadn't even finished my PhD at this point, but I realized that learning how to think like a scientist, learning how to get information from relevant sources and research it and look at it critically and analyze it, was a really valuable skill set because it allowed me to read up really quickly on a lot of energy things and learn how to help my boss, the congressman, be ready for his hearings. Well, it turned out that there was this massive blackout in the Northeast that affected my boss's district when my supervisor was on maternity leave. This blackout happened in 2003, and lo and behold, I was the person responsible for staffing him to deal with these really important, nationally significant hearings. And I was once again in my life, horrified, but I rested on my skills, and I was able to prepare him appropriately. And that is because of my science training. And then the last thing that I want to give you a more personal detail here that shows how transferable your skills are as a scientist. So five and a half years ago or so, I was diagnosed with a very rare kind of cancer. And I, any person that ever gets diagnosed with cancer is really scared. I was able to use, I'm not a medical doctor. I've never had any training in medicine, but I've had a lot of training in biology. I was able to use my training to read up all kinds of, scientific journal articles, not just random stuff on the web that is very scary, but real science, medical science, about this cancer, and make decisions that helped to make me be here right now. I mean, my doctors are the one that get all the credit, really, but I was an informed patient. And I was an informed patient in large part because I was trained as a scientist. I know how to think critically and read information and make use of it in my life. So that is my argument for why STEM fields are really worth pursuing. I desperately hope that none of you ever gets cancer. I don't want you to apply it in that way or any other serious illness. But there are a lot of ways that this applies to your life that you might not ever think about. And yeah, so that's that.
All right, we have to have questions after that one. She just lobbed you up a big old can of corn, so let's go.
Let's talk about some corn.
All right, so we have a first one over here.
If your research about the Amazonian ecosystems were so interesting, why didn't you decide to pursue that instead of oceanography?
That's a great question. Well, I was already really well into my oceanography research at this point, and honestly, I thought, well, it's... there are a couple things. I was too invested to back out and undo all the work that I'd done, but the second part is, the Amazon is so amazing, but it's makes me feel kind of claustrophobic. I'm serious. Like, that you, if you've ever experienced a really, really thick forest before, that where there's like stuff all over the place, the Amazon is that like times a million. And I thought all I could, I mean, I loved it, but I kept thinking to myself, I can't wait to get back to the ocean.
All right, we've got a question over here.
Did those experiences open other fields for you, and are you more open-minded now?
Yes and yes. So the work that I do right now, I didn't even get there, I don't do research anymore. So I run a program called Metcalfe Institute, and we train journalists to cover science more accurately and with context when they're doing their reporting. And we also train scientists to be more effective communicators. So I don't do science, but I apply my science training all the time in developing programs and writing proposals and thinking about all of these things. And yes, all of those experiences opened my mind, because I've worked with so many different kinds of people, you know, like with different goals, policy goals and science goals and journalism goals. And I'm a big believer in trying to see other people's perspectives. And so that's helped me a lot to do that.
All right, we've got one over here, and then we'll come back over.
Okay, was your first choice of college, like the college that you got into, like, or was that your only choice?
That's a great question too, no. So my very first choice was actually Duke. And this, I was gonna go early decision to Duke and all of that jazz, and this was another point in my life when my mom, who's awesome, by the way, I might not be giving that impression, but she said, it wasn't my mom. I got that wrong. I wanted to go to Duke because I had a family member who was very ill and was being treated at Duke, and so I actually had the opportunity to visit the campus because we were visiting this family member, and the Duke campus is just beautiful, and I fell in love with it. And so I was gonna do this, and it was actually a friend of mine in high school who was like, Sunshine, you know, you can't really afford to go to Duke. Your folks certainly can't do this. You can't do this. So how about you go to a state school where, and at the time, it was, you know, not super expensive to go to Michigan State if you were in state. They're like, why don't you go there for a couple of years and then you can transfer? And I was like, okay, yeah, sure, you're right, Eric, that makes sense. So that was my plan, but I never transferred. I loved Michigan State and I was really happy to be there.
All right. Have we had somebody who hasn't asked a question yet? Okay, yep.
Was there any challenges that changed your path in your education?
Yeah, well, my first year as a, you know how I said that I wanted to go from like the big fish in the little pond to the teeny fish in the big pond from high school to college? Well, I did that, and then I kind of drowned in the pond for my first year. I did not get very good grades. And then I had come in with some scholarships that I realized I was going to lose those scholarships if I wasn't careful because I really let my grades slip. And it was partly just, you know, this happens sometimes when people go to college. Their first year, they get a little distracted, and I got a lot distracted. And that didn't really, it didn't change my career path necessarily, but it changed how I thought about school. You know, I realized I had always thought school was easy for me, you know? I got good grades. I was salutatorian in my high school, in my teeny tiny little high school. So I thought that meant school was always going to be easy and I didn't have to work super hard. And I realized, no, in fact, I do have to work really hard. So it definitely helped me understand that different situations require different responses. And so I had to change the way I was approaching school. And that was a really important lesson.
Let's go, let me take one down here, and then we'll come over here, and then we'll go back up. So, go ahead right here.
So, like, as a stereotypical millennial, whenever someone tells me that what I want to do is impractical, I still go for it, and it works. So, like, what made you step down when your friend told you about Duke, or when your parents told you about being in the
manager? I'm a very good girl. I'm a first child, and I don't like to disappoint people. That's really the answer.
Do we have another? Right over here. Okay. Yes.
Hold on. Use the microphone.
Yeah, let me.
When you got a B minus in your oceanography class, did you ever consider not retaking it?
Yeah, there was a minute there when I thought, that's it, I'm done. I can't be an oceanographer. And that, so that class was a fall class, and I remember going home over the break, over the holidays, and having, you know, I could cry right now thinking about this all over again. That's how like, ugh, it was like a punch in the gut. It was the most horrible thing. So I remember the feeling of like, wow, maybe I'm just not cut out for this. And you know what? When I was interviewing at grad schools, and I interviewed at URI's Graduate School of Oceanography, I remember having a meeting with a professor there who said, you know, looking at your GREs, I have some concerns about your math skills. I don't know if you can do this. So, of course, when I got that B minus in the physical oceanography course, this is replaying in my head, and I thought maybe he's right. But again, persistence is the thing. I decided that I wasn't going to quit, and so I didn't quit. I didn't think about quitting for very long, but the short time when I was thinking about it, I thought about it very seriously.
All right, let me take the next one because we've had a lot of questions up here. I'll come back up there, but I want to get these down here.
You talked about your confidence a lot. How were you able to just like keep your confidence up? Like, is there something you did or said to yourself, or just you just had good confidence?
You know, a little bit of it is fake it till you make it. I see some nodding. that is a real thing. And again, I think especially for a lot of women, that's a real thing. And it is for men too. I don't mean to downplay this. Clearly there are plenty of men out there who also lack the confidence, but there's kind of like men are socially, you know, like expected to be more confident, I think. And then there's a point at which you're, depending on who you are and how you think about things, you just are like, this is a thing I want to do, and I'm going to do it. And so you do the fake it till you make it part to a certain point, and then beyond that, you just have to push through and, you know, swallow your pride sometimes a little bit. And in my experience, it usually works out.
Great. Now, also, I just want to say at this point, too, we're going to kind of open this up. So if you have questions for any of the original speakers as well, please feel free just to let us know which speaker you're asking the question to. So where did I have my next one? Let's go back up here. Let's go to the one right next to you, Veronica.
What would you say to someone like me who dislikes math about considering a career in STEM?
And anybody can answer that. Let's start with Sunshine.
Well, I hope you will take from my story that it is still very, very possible to have a career in STEM even if you don't love math. I won't say that I hate math. It's just that it always intimidated me a little bit. It was not my strongest skill. But, you know, so maybe I had to work a little bit harder at it to make it work. Maybe I had to take a class twice to make it work, but I got through it. And it is, I mean, math is essential for most STEM fields, but there are, you know, you don't have to do programming. You don't have to do computational modeling. There are a lot of ways that you can be involved in a STEM field that doesn't require really intensive math. And so, you know, I think the first thing is to figure out what you enjoy and whether that has a lot of math in it or not. What makes you happy? And once you figure that out, then you deal with what comes along with it. If that means that you need to figure out how to spend some more time making sense of math, then great. I had a friend who's a physicist who once said to me, you know, and he's this really like cool dude, you know, he was like, and he studies the origins of the universe. So he's a really like crazy out there kind of physicist guy. And he's like, you know, I think math is like a language, and you know, it's a beautiful language. And for someone like me who loves languages, I was like, right. Okay, I can see that. It is like a language. So sometimes it's just about changing your perspective a little bit, and that helps you think about things like math a little bit differently. What else?
Does anybody else want to answer that?
just you guys are in a weird position where technology, and I know we've talked about this a lot, is very normal to you. You don't think twice about doing things on a computer. And I'll tell you right now, at least I'd say for the next 15 to 20 years, that alone will get you into a STEM field. Because a lot of people in senior positions are incredibly uncomfortable with technology. And so you're kind of the bridge generation. I think that won't be true forever, but I think it's definitely true now that if you go in there and you can do something as simple as, you know, realize that you turn the computer back on to get Windows to work, and they'll be, wow, that's amazing. You know, so, you know, to you, you know, or this is how you get to your contacts in your cell phone. I mean, this is really difficult for a lot of people in senior positions still, and it seems crazy, but it's true. So that will get you into a STEM field alone. Yeah.
So to answer your question, I despised math in high school. Absolutely despised it. Despised it so much that I didn't get into my first choice college because the SAT score for the math portion was that low. So that kind of sucked for me. Didn't get my first choice. So when I decided on engineering, you have to just be like, I love this field. I love science. This is what I want to do with the rest of my life. And you just have to be like, just kind of suck it up and go for it.
But Kim, how much math do you do on a daily basis in your job now?
Oh, none. None. That's what I have engineers for. So I didn't have to do all that math. But because I switched career paths to project management instead of going for the full engineering degree, that kind of helped me. But I still have way too much math to get that AS. So yeah, but I don't have to do any of it now.
Another question? All right, well, one here, and then we're going to go up to the young lady up there.
From your perspective, what advice would you give to us millennials who often get called snowflakes about, like, situations in which your past would, like, derail and go
on? Your past or? Your past. Derail. I think it's a rare person whose past does not derail.
Yeah.
So I think, I know for me this light bulb came on later in my life. I wish I'd understood this when I was younger, is that nobody's path is, and nobody's confident, and nobody knows more. You know, it's just everyone's nervous. Everyone questions what they're doing. Everyone here said they didn't want to speak first because they didn't want to be first. You know, so, and when that realization comes, it's like everyone's nervous. Everyone has to overcome obstacles. And you just keep going. You don't give up.
Anyone else want to
say? So just stay positive with yourself. Even when you feel that, you know, you can't overcome it, if you put enough will, there's always a way. That's my big motto. If there's a will, there's a way. You can pretty much do whatever you want to do. But how much effort are you willing to put into it is the real question. You know what I mean? Do you want to say anything?
I'll stop.
For people that really, like, their parents say that they can do anything, but when you really tell your parents that you feel, they feel like you can't do it, and you feel the doubt that they have in you, how do you get through it?
So I came from a family of nurses, and that's where my path was supposed to be. And, you know, my mom's like, oh, there's more money, there's more this, but that's not what makes me happy. So I just put that aside, and I just followed what I knew I was good at. I mean, that's working with computers and working with people, showing them that technology is not that scary. And back to what she said about turning the PC on, that's a real thing still till this day, turning PCs on. And just stay focused. Don't let the negative thoughts get to you. And just keep doing you and do what you feel and make you happy.
Another question? We'll go here, and then we'll go back over here. There's a gentleman, or who's up? The gentleman in the back, yep.
When working with computers and other types of technology, did you have any technical difficulties?
All the time.
I swear at my computer on a daily basis. I spent all day yesterday trying to figure out why one of my drivers, which is basically the code that runs the various pieces of your computer, wouldn't work. Literally all day. And I was swearing and I was angry. So all the time. Yeah, computers suck, but they're also amazing. You know, and I think we all think that probably.
Yeah, absolutely. For my AS degree here, I had to take MATLAB. And as someone who, for some reason, like technology, like runs away from me, like not good at it whatsoever. Like I'm the one that will call her and be like, "How do I turn my PC on?" MATLAB was so hard, so challenging. I was borderline, almost failed the class. So even if you're not like technically inclined, there's still so many more resources around you now that you can get through it if you need to. And sometimes you look back and you're like, "Oh, that was actually kind of cool," even though I, you know, almost pulled my hair out halfway through it. So.
Thank God for Google and YouTube, right?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Whenever I get stuck with a technology question, Google is my main source. Absolutely love it. YouTube, if you're a visual learner, you can figure anything you want on YouTube and Google nowadays. So take advantage of those free tools out there.
All right. Let's come. We'll take the gentleman up here, and then I'm going to come back down to these two ladies, and then I think we're going to kind of wrap it up. Wasn't there a gentleman up there that wanted? All right, well then we will come back down here to these two ladies, and then we'll go back up if there is one.
Okay, so all of you seem to be like pretty far along on like your path. What do you guys see like in the future for your career?
I still don't know what I want to be. So I'm only 25 years old. I've had that straightforward path, unlike these ladies over here. I was fortunate to get in right after high school, and I kind of just stuck with it, loved it. But honestly, to be 100% honest with you, I'm 25 years old. I don't really know where I want to shift to. What I do know I like is helping people understand technology. So I'm thinking leaning towards more of a teaching degree, possibly here at BCC or at a high school, to show students and people and that technology isn't scary, and with enough will, of course, there's a way. And just be patient with it.
I'm not 25 years old. My son is 25 years old. A lot of people here also talked about the fact they love to learn. They love learning new things. And I think, honestly, I probably will not stay in my current career simply because I love to learn, and I'm always finding things that fascinate me. And I always want to try to go there. And at this point in my life, I know that I can. And I think, you know, that's a good lesson, that if you really are want to do something, you're fascinated by something, it's usually a way there. And you'll probably do that for most of your life.
I'm going to be 30 this year. And I've only been a project manager for like 15 months now. And I for the future, I just want to finish my degree. I just want to get my bachelor's, and I just want to work for a while. Like, I don't want to do anything but just work. Because working and going to school at the same time is so hard, so you don't get to enjoy actually working and staying late at the office and kind of delving more into the projects at work. So for the foreseeable future, I just want to work.
So I'm 43, since we're admitting our ages here. And I definitely want to do a lot of different things. So something that is kind of on the back of my brain, and I don't know how soon I'll do it, is environmental mediation, which is where you sit two parties that have conflicts with each other down related to an environmental issue. And as the mediator, you're the person who kind of helps them come to some agreement on something. And I really like helping people find middle ground. I'm a big believer in negotiation. And so I think that's probably the next big move that I will make, but I'm not going to do that anytime soon.
And I just want to follow up that with what you just heard was Dr. Menezes just say a job you probably have never even heard of, that probably does not exist in any database today. So the jobs that some of you and many of you will be doing in the future don't even exist today. So your ability to think beyond that is also a big piece of that. And so we're going to finish off with one last question.
A lot of pressure.
Did any of you take any steps in high school to better your successes in the STEM fields?
Um, I basically took all the math and science classes I could. I tolerated English and history in those classes and took every math and science class I could, but because that's what I loved.
I didn't. I had to start completely from scratch. So all of my stuff was, my high school had like a sub school within it called law and government. So I did all that, and all my volunteer work was like in the community or at the courthouse, or we had a mock trial and debate team. So like that was all my stuff. So I literally had to start from scratch. And the only thing that kept me moving forward was we have an engineering club here at the school. And that was just being around like-minded people who were struggling like me was a big help. That was how I kind of furthered that. But yeah, just kidding.
Coming from Bristol Aggie, I think now they have a computer class. But when I attended, there was no STEM programs there. It was just kind of like, you know, farm stuff, agriculture, all that good stuff. But what I was able to do is I've always had an interest in technology, like I mentioned, and I just basically turned a hobby into a career. And that's what I really liked about it. So that what helped me was fixing friends' computers, you know, doing all that crazy stuff you see on YouTube, downloading music, all that fun stuff. I was really like nerdy. Like, do you guys remember MySpace? Yeah. So you know that those cool layouts, like the person that made them, that was me. Like, I would make layouts for my friends. Like, that's what I thought was a good time on Saturday night, was making HTML layouts for my friend's MySpace page.
So I'm old enough that again, went to this very small school, so that when I went to high school, people, volunteering was not a thing. Like, it was not expected that you have 50 gajillion volunteer experiences by the time you graduated from high school. So I took science courses also, but something that actually was kind of a big deal to me was we had this club called the Outdoors Club, and it was just about going on trips in the outdoors, you know, so like we would go on camping trips or fishing trips or whatever. Again, it was Northern Michigan. So that was, even though it was about hanging out outside with my friends and doing these outdoorsy things, there was a lot of learning about the natural environment that went on within that. So I think that, you know, opportunities that you can take advantage of to explore your passion in a really low pressure way is a nice way to build out your kind of your base of understanding about what's out there.
With that, we're going to draw the questions to a close, but I do want to let you know, we're going to stay around here for a little while afterwards, so that if you want to come down and ask a specific question to one of the individuals, we'll be here. But I want to kind of wrap this up with a couple of key things. First off, I want to thank our panelists for their time today, because I think it's incredibly important to hear their stories and for you to be able to talk with them directly. So please, a round of applause for all of our panelists. And then we heard a few things today, and I want to bring those back. As you walk out today and you think about what did you hear in the panel today, there were some themes that ran across that I think each of our panelists spoke about. First, one of the things that we heard was, get out of your comfort zone. There are going to be times that you don't feel comfortable with something. Don't let that hold you back. If you are willing to expand and go outside of that space, it's amazing what you're going to find out there. Two. Perception. Don't let perception become your reality. There's a ton of research about math in particular, and women and men in math. And one of the things that comes out is that many times, as Dr. Menezes, sorry, okay. My Spanish wants to take your name and make it Spanish. Menezes mentioned it. Many times when you are sitting in a calculus class, especially in college, and you are a female, you are sitting there and you are drudging through the calculus. And sometimes, especially when you get up into Calc 3 and different Qs, you may not have a lot of other women with you always. It'll be a lot smaller females in that group, as Kim can attest to. And so you're sitting there and you're going, oh my gosh, I just got a C on this midterm. And you're thinking, I'm not smart enough to continue on with engineering. And you're looking it over at all the guys, and they're all like, yeah, everything's great. What you don't know is the guy's got C's too. But when a guy gets a C, he goes, yeah, I got a C, I'm good to go, I'm moving on. And when we, many times as women, we feel that we have to be up here, it's gotta be that A, and that expectation that if we're not getting A's, then we're not going to be successful, you've got to let go of some of that. One of it is perception, and two of it is, there's gonna be times that it's going to be tough. It's going to be a challenge. And that brings me to my third one. perseverance. You've got to just persevere. Know that if you want it bad enough, don't let those things, don't let those little blips in the road stop you from what you want to do. Reach out to somebody, find a mentor, find somebody who can help you. There are no reasons why you can't get past it, and sometimes it is just a matter of just going through the steps and getting it done. It may not be pretty, but as I asked Kim to, say, is that she doesn't do math on a daily basis. She just had to get through math. It's part of a degree requirement. And then the last one that I wanted to bring up was opportunities. Don't let those opportunities slip by. Don't feel like I'm not gonna put in an application because I'm not gonna be competitive. There are enough people in your life that are gonna take you out of the competition. Don't you take yourself out of that competition, because you never know who all is in the competition with you. And I see that happen by students all the time. Well, I don't think I'm good enough. You don't even know who the pool is that you're competing against. So don't you take yourself out. Let others do that for you. And then you can deal with the ramifications afterwards. And then the last thing I'm going to just say, if these are things that are of interest to you, there's some good books out there if these are areas that you want to go and you are a reader and you want to go down that path. There's a really recent book out called Lab Girl. It is a... it's a memoir, but she is a... And I'm terrible because now I can't...
Hope Jaharin.
It's a wonderful book. She is a botanist, and she talks about her whole pathway of how she came through, and it's actually very well written, so if you like to read, I would encourage you to look at Lab Girl. Also, another one, we talked about confidence. There's a book out there, it's a few years old now, it's called Confidence Code. It's a nice book because it focuses on both biological and neurological, and also nurture over nature. So it has a lot of research in there about things that we do, and it's based from a woman's perspective of how do we build that confidence. Sometimes we have to build that confidence within ourselves. And then last but not least, those of you who are thinking maybe science, it's important for us in sciences, and I think again, I think you heard it here, but also today, that ability to be able to speak scientifically and to be able to defend what you're talking about is very important. There's a book, it's quite old now, but it's called Don't Be Such a Scientist. And it's the importance of being able to, as a scientist, how do we tell our story and how do we get others to understand it? Because as scientists, many times we love all the data, but data's really boring when you're trying to talk to others about it. And so it's a book about how can we change that perspective. So I just kind of leave it at that. With that, I want to say thank you. We do have